Can you hear me? Wow. I mean, really, wow. What an incredible, incredible time that God has blessed us with. You know, I've lived in bigger communities than Odessa. I've lived in smaller communities than Odessa, and we've never seen anything like what God's done in Odessa. I mean, God, we are lucky to live where we live, folks. I don't know if you understand that, but we are lucky to live here. God has truly, truly blessed us. Let me give you some of the statistics before I recognize some of the people. We had over 230 people involved this weekend from our churches here in Odessa doing volunteer work. We put on a roof, we put on siding, we ripped off decking, we've done countless yard work from all over Odessa. We redid almost a whole home, stripped off the whole exterior and redid it. God really, really allowed us to do some incredible things with 230 people. And I don't know if you guys watched the weather report last week, but every night at 10:17, I would turn on Gary Lezak. And I would watch that weather report, and it said every single day last week that there was a 70% chance of rain on Friday, and I prayed. And we came together on Wednesday night, and we prayed. And guess what? On Thursday night, whenever I got home and I turned on the news at 10:17 at night, and I watched the news, and they did that timeline, you know what I'm talking about? They did the timeline of when the weather was going to hit and where it was going to be at what times. This is no lie. We were meeting here at 7 a.m., and at 6:55, that front just disappeared. The rain cleared. That's God, folks. I don't know if you get it. That is what God does. That is what God does. He paves the way. He prepares the way for us to do the work that he has for us. It's an incredible journey. It's an incredible thing. Even though some of the jobs were a little too wet, there was a little thing that God gave us most of the time called Facebook. And we just wrote on Facebook, hey, community, we need some jobs. And I'm telling you, we had more jobs within the blink of an eye than we could turn away. And we were sending crews every which way. And I'm just telling you, the intergenerational factor of this weekend is what I love the most. To sit back and see kids from little kids, you saw it on the video, everybody oohed and aahed at the Unruh kids. Man, they're so cute, you know. And they were out there doing everything with everybody else, and they were right in the thick of things from the Unruh kids all the way up. And I just have to brag on a couple people just real quick. Adair Carlisle. Adair Carlisle is my new hero. I'm serious. Her, always Nancy Miller is my hero. But Adair and Nancy sat in the office here at the church for the last 2 days, and every phone call that came in that was requesting, and this isn't just residents calling in requesting work, this is our crews calling in and saying, we're done with this job, where do we go? We need a 2x4, send somebody to Home Depot. And Adair and Nancy had that together, where they called runners that were waiting at Home Depot, and those runners got those boards back to wherever they were going, and they did an incredible job, and without them, we wouldn't have had this weekend. And then last night, I'm telling you, last night was one of the highlights of my whole career here in Odessa. I've never seen anything like it. We really thought that these block parties were going to be a huge flop. I'll just be honest with you. Whenever we started planning this and I started talking to people about it, I'm like, man, nobody's going to show up. And last night, Gary and I, we were going from park to park, and there were some glitches, and we worked them all out. And as we pulled up to Phillips Street Park, I don't know if you know where Phillips Street Park is, but it's a very small park in the middle of Mason and Dryden, kind of on the north end of town. And we pulled up to Phillips Park, and here comes the cops and the fire truck and the ambulance to let the kids climb on it for these block parties. And no joke, from the trailer parks around, those little homes all around, you saw people flooding down the streets, flooding in herds. I would say there were over 250 people just in that one city park, and they were just conversing and hanging out and eating hot dogs. And we only had 200 hot dogs, but we walked away with more. I don't know how God did it, but he did it. God was amazing. the intergenerational part of it, seeing young and old come together to serve their community is just amazing. The people who were served were moved, but I'm just telling you, the people who served were moved more. And we see that time and time again on all of these events and all of these trips that we do. We don't do these just because we need something to do. We do them because it's not only making a difference in the life of our community, it's making a difference in our lives as well. And God is doing something in this church, and we're so, so lucky to be here. The most important part about the whole thing is that we know for sure that we saw at least two people come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Hundreds of people heard the gospel this weekend. Nicole Lockhart told a story last night as we had a little share time about they went to a trailer park in Bait City and did a backyard Bible club, and they were able to present the gospel to 17 people at one time. And just it just clicked in my head. How many of us are able to share the gospel with 17 people over an entire year? And in one weekend, we're able to share the gospel with 17 people at one time. I mean, folks, if this doesn't excite you about what God's doing in your community, something is wrong with you. Get involved, get plugged in. God is moving, and where God is moving, you need to join him. I love Henry Blackaby came and spoke whenever I was 10 years old in Neosho, and he said, "You find where God is moving and you join him there." I love it, because we have this whole idea that God's going to come and he's going to make us do something. That's not how God works. You find where God's moving and you join him there. And folks, I don't know, and I'm not saying First Baptist, I'm not saying Calvary, I'm not saying any of the churches. What I'm saying is God is moving in Odessa, and let's join him in our community that we love and that we live. And God's going to do something great. That's why we wear our shirts this morning. I Heart Odessa, because we do love our community. We love our hometown. So if you took part in Dismiss Weekend, if you took part in that, Dismiss, D-I-S, stands for discipleship. M-I-S-S stands for missions. We disciple the kids in the evening, and we do missions during the day. Dismiss Weekend, that's what it stands for. If you were a part of Dismiss Weekend, would you stand? Doesn't matter if you were a host home, if you answered phones, whatever you did, we want to recognize you and thank you for your service to our community. I especially want to thank Brian and Julie Henning for letting me ride their scooter around all weekend. It was awesome. You ever had sticker shock? You walked up to something and you thought you were going to pay this price, and you walk up and you get to the cash register and they tell you a different price and it's a lot higher than what you thought it was going to be. Have you ever had that happen to you? Or you had this much budgeted to go and buy a big purchase, and you get to that big purchase and you realize, oh, this is going to cost me a whole lot more than what I thought? Or how many of you have had it the other way, where you've had sticker shock in a good way, that you've walked up somewhere and you thought that you were going to have to pay this amount for something, but then it ended up being cheaper on you? You know what I'm talking about? This morning, what we want to talk about in the sermon title this morning is the cost of following Jesus. The cost of following Jesus. You know, a lot of times I think about the true cost of following Jesus. I think about it in the terms that we don't really understand it. We think in our culture that following Jesus is going to cost our lifestyle. We're going to have to be poor. We're going to have to give everything away. We're going to have to constantly be in religious activities. And we think about in that way. But in fact, and I don't know if you know this, and if you're wearing a white shirt, you probably know what I'm talking about. Then it changes, and we get that sticker shock on the other side, and we're like, this is the best thing that I could have ever done with my life. I'm so excited, because the cost, yes, it costs something to follow Jesus, but it's in a good way. It's costing me something, but I get so much back in return. I'm the one that truly gets blessed from following Jesus and serving Jesus, and it doesn't cost near as much as what we think it's going to cost us. So at first, we think it's going to be some horrible, costly adventure in our life. But really, the true cost of following Jesus may cost something up front, but in the end, we get so, so much more. Our life is so much more blessed. You know, I look on Facebook all the time. I don't know if you've ever done this, but everybody that I went to high school with, they just look old. I don't know what the deal is. As I get older, they just look old, and I don't think I look that old, but I definitely don't feel that old on the inside. I talk to senior adults all the time, and they're like, I still feel like I'm 18, but my body doesn't feel like I'm 18 anymore. And that's exactly right, right? And so I look on Facebook, and I see all these friends from high school and how their lives are so drastically different from my life or the people that I surround myself with. And I see that they constantly go through hardships, they constantly go through trials, and they have no one to turn to because they have no Jesus. They have no one, they have no community that they put themselves in, like a church community. They have no one when something bad happens. So what do? They drink their lives away, right? I can guarantee you that the life of a person who follows Jesus is always better. No matter your circumstances, it's always better than the person who does not follow Jesus. No question in my mind. I've seen it over and over and over again in my life. And I know that you've seen it too. So today we're going to talk about the true cost of following Jesus. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn to the book of Luke. And we're going to look in Luke 18. We're going to talk through about this guy that was looking for a way to follow Jesus and asking questions about following Jesus. And Jesus told him what following him really looks like. And I love Jesus' response to this. And what happens is an interesting factual account in Scripture. Luke chapter 18, verses 18 through 30. If you have it this morning, hold your Bibles up so we can see it. Luke 18, verses 18 through 30. It says, a certain ruler asked him, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus responds in verse 19, and I love this. Why do you call me good? Jesus answered, no one is good except God alone. Now you see, whenever I used to read this scripture, I used to think, Jesus is saying that he's not good. Right? Jesus is saying right here, he's not good. Jesus, why are you saying that? But see, Jesus isn't saying that he's not good. Jesus is saying that he is God. Did you catch that? That's what he's saying here. He says, why do you call me good? Jesus answered, no one is good except God alone. You see, the rich guy here recognized that Jesus was good, and Jesus took the opportunity to tell him exactly who he was. Why do you call me good? Jesus answered. No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother. And the man responds, all these I have kept since I was a boy, he said. When Jesus heard this, he said to him, you still lack one thing. Sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. When he heard this, he became very sad because he was very wealthy. Jesus looked at him and said, how hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God? Indeed, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. Let me just say, after returning from Nicaragua, and I shared this with the Nicaragua group, there's not one person in here. And I don't care if we worked on your house this weekend or we didn't. There's not one person in here that's not rich. God's given us so much. God has given us so much. We all have more stuff and more house than you could ever imagine. Indeed, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. Those who heard this asked, who then can be saved? Jesus replied, what is impossible with man is possible with God. Peter said to him, we have left all we had to follow you. I love Peter. He's like, hey, what about us? Verse 29, truly I tell you, Jesus said to them, no one who has left home or wife or brothers or sisters or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will fail to receive many times as much. Now listen. In this age and in the age to come, eternal life. in this age and in the age to come, eternal life. Man, that's a lot of stuff. It's a lot of good stuff in that scripture. Let's talk through it. If we really want to truly know what it costs to follow Jesus, there's some things that we need to really examine in our own life. Now, follow me, because I really want us to get what God's trying to say this morning. We need to examine our own life to really figure out if we're giving the cost of what it truly takes to follow him. This isn't some feel-good time. I really want you to try to figure out, and me to figure out, and my family to figure out, are we truly doing what it costs to follow Jesus and have an ultimate relationship with him? And as we come off a weekend like this, no better time to examine our own life than now. So to truly follow Jesus, we must do a couple things. The first bullet, first blank in your outline. If we want to truly follow Jesus, we must, number one, examine our condition. Examine our condition. How do you live? How do you live right now? I mean, really think about it. How do you live? Whenever we were in Nicaragua, I shared this as well, but I hear all the time, they're so poor. Oh, but they're so content. How do they do that? I feel so sorry for them, right? We throw all these pronouns around about they and them and how bad they have it. And one day it just dawned on me, and it started to bug me, that everybody kept saying, oh, they're so poor. Oh, I feel so sorry for them. And it just dawned on me that it was really upsetting me. And the reason it was really upsetting me is because we look at it from an Americanized point of view. We look at it and we feel sorry for them because they don't have as much stuff that we have. But here's the reality, folks. They are in the same condition that we are in. We are all sinners. We all need a Savior. And we are all going to hell unless we accept Jesus. Period. That's it. It doesn't matter if you're white or black or gay or straight or whatever you are. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, your condition is flawed and you have to fix it. We are all in the same condition. Every single one of us that breathes breath in and out are all in the same condition. We all are going to go to hell unless we accept Jesus as our Savior. We all have a need for a Savior. It doesn't matter what kind of house you live in. It doesn't matter where you go to school. It doesn't matter where you go to church. Look, I know people who go to this church that have a flawed condition, and I'm one of them. We are all the same. We are all the same. And whenever we realize and examine our own condition, and we stop judging other people for what they do, and we start looking at our inner heart and say, we sin just as much as they, it just looks different. Whenever we start to look at that condition and examine it, guess what? We start to understand the true cost of following Jesus. It's that we have to give up ourselves and figure out our condition and run, not walk, not skip, run toward him. The boys and I stayed up till about 2:30 last night just talking through, and we kind of came up with this whole idea of our condition and what our condition looks like. You know, we're really good at sometimes confessing our sin to each other. But whenever we confess our sin to each other, unless there's repentance attached to that confession, all it is bragging. Unless there is true repentance, which means turning around and running away from that sin, unless there's true repentance with that confession, all you're doing is bragging. We have to understand what condition that we're in. We are in a condition that we need a Savior. And once you've found a Savior, that doesn't mean that your condition has improved at all, unless you start looking at other people's condition as something that you can help instead of something that we judge. A lot of stuff going on in the news this week. A lot of stuff. And I'm not going to get into any of it. All I'm saying is that before we start pointing fingers and posting on Facebook, you need to examine your condition, and I need to examine my condition. Capiche? When we realize that our true condition is, then we'll start to understand the need for the sanctification process in our own life and the need, the desperate need that the world and our community has for the gospel of Jesus. When we truly understand our condition, we truly understand the condition of others around us, we understand the need for the sanctification process in our own life and the need for the gospel to be preached to our community and to the nations. I want to be a part of it. I don't want to sit back anymore. I want to go. I want to be a part of it. Whether it's to Patricia's or Cost Plus, whether it's to McDonald's. Look, I was wearing this shirt, this very shirt. And yes, my shirt was clean on Friday, but I wore a dirty one on Saturday, all right? We drove through McDonald's. Katie Lockhart and Gary and I were going around to all the sites, and we drove through McDonald's. And the drive-through lady stuck her head out, and she goes, "What's with all the shirts? Everybody's coming through to get dollar drinks. What's with all the shirts?" We're able to tell her what we were doing. She's like, "That's awesome. That's awesome." Something as silly as a shirt can open up an avenue for the gospel. It can. Last night at the parks, we didn't pray at the parks. Some people did. That's okay. But we don't want it to be a church event. We want it to be a community event where people can come and they can feel safe. And you know what? That they can see that church people are just like any other people in the whole world. That we all have the same condition. We need a sanctification process, and we need to share the gospel. To truly follow Jesus, number two, we must examine our sacrifice. We must examine our sacrifice. This is a tough one for me. I'll be honest. But I don't see any part in Scripture that God has not always required a sacrifice out of us. Always. From the beginning to now, God has always required us as followers of Him to have a sacrifice of some sort. Look at what Scripture says in verse 22. It says, "When Jesus heard this, He said to him, 'You still lack one thing. Sell everything that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me.'" You know, Shay and I were blessed just in the last couple months. We bought a new house. We bought a house just right around the corner, and so not a lot of people knew that we moved, but we just bought a house right around the corner, and we feel so incredibly blessed. But am I willing to get rid of that house tomorrow if God told me to get rid of my house? Am I willing to go somewhere without my wife and my kids, without anybody else, if God called me to do that? I struggle with that because I don't know if you know this about me, but I grew up so poor that I have to have the security of something at home. I have to have that kind of security in my life. It's just something that I've always dealt with. It's one of the struggles in my whole life I've dealt with that I even, and I know that this sounds crazy because I sound like a hoarder and my wife hates me for it. No, she doesn't. She doesn't hate me. But my closet is bigger than hers. Is that crazy? I know. And I have every t-shirt in my closet color-coded. And t-shirts, I mean, like, I love Odessa t-shirts, like, lined up on the white side. That's no joke. And the reason is because we could never afford clothes whenever I was younger, and I'm too afraid to let them go. Plus, every Monday I start a diet, and I think I'm going to fit back into those clothes. But are we examining our sacrifice? Jesus isn't calling us to sell our house and get rid of our families. I really don't think that that's what this scripture is talking about. I don't think He's telling us to sell everything and run away. What I think that He's saying is that following Him costs something. And see, as followers of Him, we come to nice air-conditioned buildings and we go on fun air-conditioned trips and we do all this stuff. And there's really no sacrifice in an American's life to follow Jesus any longer. There's really no sacrifice of following Jesus any longer. And if we did have to sacrifice something, I'm not sure how many of us would be coming here on a regular basis. He's asking us not to sacrifice our families, all that stuff. Here's what I really believe that God's asking us to do. I think that God's truly asking us to be completely dependent on Him. That's what I really think. I don't think that it's all about selling everything you own and giving it all away and blah, blah, blah. I think that it's about complete dependency on him. You know, we talked about this. I keep going back to this because we talked about a lot of this stuff in Nicaragua too. What is it? Why do we think that the Nicaraguans are, oh, we feel so sorry for them, blah, blah, blah. It's because we have more stuff, right? And my argument, and I saw this, the Nicaraguans that we served are so in tune with God. I mean, they may have nothing, but they're worshiping their hearts up and raising their hands, and they're loving their families like I've never seen. People in this church don't even love their families like these people love their families, and I couldn't get it. And then it dawned on me, and I understood it because I kind of remember going through this whenever I was a teenager. I had nothing, no family around me that even cared 2 cents about me, and I remember that the only person I could depend on was my Jesus. And that's what got me through. And that's exactly what happens in Nicaragua every single day for those people. They have nothing else to depend on. They don't have bank accounts. They don't have savings accounts. In fact, the average Nicaraguan makes less than $2 a month. Feel sorry for them, right? I don't. Because they have a better relationship with Jesus than what I do. Because they have to be completely dependent on him. I whined to Ken Jobe when my air conditioner and my Hyundai went out. I did, didn't I? It's just crazy. What are we sacrificing to follow Jesus? And if we're not sacrificing something, then we need to start. Are we sacrificing our time? Our money? What are we sacrificing? What are we sacrificing? If you can't think of something that you're sacrificing, you better examine your following of Jesus. Better examine your relationship. Number three. This is my favorite one, and I'm about to get up in your business. Number three. To truly follow Jesus, we must examine our attitude. Ooh. All right, which one of you guys am I going to pick on today? No, I'm just kidding. Examine our attitude. You ever seen Sesame Street? You know what cartoon I'm talking about? Sesame Street. I lived on Sesame Street whenever I was growing up. I couldn't wait for Ozarks Public Television out of Springfield to put on Sesame Street at 9 a.m. every single weekday morning, and I would sit down, and Big Bird was my favorite. I don't know why. He was my favorite. But I remember Oscar the Grouch. Anybody ever seen Oscar the Grouch? And he lives in a trash can, and he comes out, and he's this green puppet, and he's always mad about something. He's always griping. He never has a smile on his face, right? And I think about the church. And you walk into this building, and there are people that don't even look other people in the eye. There are people who are so upset about something that the person they're upset about doesn't even know what's going on. Listen, there's people in my family that I have a hard time with, but they're still my family. I still have to talk to them. I still have to love on them. Whether you like it or not, we're all family here, all right? We're God's family. And God's put us together for a reason. And the reason is too great for us to have a bad attitude any longer. The purpose is too big for us to have a bad attitude. Stop griping about things. I don't care what church you go to. Gary, you got some gripers up at Calvary? Yeah, I'm sure you do. Yeah. Lisa, stop griping. All right? Look, we're going to get on each other's nerves. Things are going to happen. People are going to make you upset. Look at what this says. Verse 23 and 24. When he heard this, he became very sad. Jesus just told him, it came from the horse's mouth. Jesus said, this is what it's going to take for you to follow me. If Jesus said that to me, I think I'd listen, right? What did he do? He became very sad because he was very wealthy. Jesus looked at him and said, how hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God? See, we seem to think that following Jesus is a drag, that's no fun. We think, and I'm telling you, I've heard non-Christians say this, I'm not ready for that. I'm not ready for it. What? You're not ready to spend eternity in heaven? Whatever. Because they think that we're going to make them stop living in sin, and that we're going to make them stop drinking their favorite drink. And listen, I don't know if you've watched Facebook this summer. We've had some fun. I mean, we have had some fun. The church has been alive, and we have gone to different places all over the world, and we've seen God move in an incredible way. And listen, if that doesn't get you out of your funk of an attitude, I don't know what will. Joy is the key. Joy is the key to our Christian life. I'm going to read this so I don't mess it up. Joy is the difference in someone following Jesus because they have to versus following Jesus because they want to. That's what true joy is all about. We think that we have to in order to go to heaven. We think that we have to because our moms and dads believed it. We think that we have to because of all of the above. But listen, whenever you understand that we follow Jesus because we want to, that's whenever you're going to drop your attitude and you're going to have a different outlook on life. You're going to have joy in your life. I remember when I changed. I do. And it was here. It was while I worked here. I used to be grumpy. I used to get mad, right? Then I saw Jenny. Most joyful person. Betsy Hodges, most joyful person. Deanie, I can name them. I thought, you know what? Nothing's worth this. Nothing's worth going home and being upset about it every night. Let's just have joy, folks. That's it. You have to do something hard in the church. Big whoop, move on. Change your attitude. Why is it? Why is it that we need to examine and change our attitude? Because that's what God requires. We want to be sad because we have to follow Jesus? No, let's be joyful because we get to follow Jesus. Because he sent his son to die on a cross for our sins, without which none of us would be here, without which none of us would be promised an eternal life. Listen, you are not too intellectual to believe in the saving grace of Jesus Christ. You're not too smart. God has something for us if we change our attitude. The problem with our attitude is that we find our identity in so many different places. You heard that word, sexual identity? When did we start placing our identity in who we sleep with? When? See, if our identity lies in anything other than Jesus Christ, then you are on a wrong path. I don't care if your identity is in the car you drive, it's in the house you live in, it's in the family that you live with. I don't care what you find your identity. If it's in anything other than Jesus, then you're wrong. And I'm wrong. This is all-encompassing this morning. I told you I was going to get in your business. I'm sorry, but I'm really not. All right? When we examine our condition, when we examine our sacrifice, and we examine our attitude, we get to the fourth and last one, which is the best one. We get to experience true blessings. We get to experience true blessings. That word has changed in my thought process this past year. I don't look at blessing the same way that I used to. Look at what it says in verses 29 and 30. It says, truly I tell you, Jesus said to them, no one who has left home or wife or brothers or sisters or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will fail to receive many times as much in this age and in the age to come, eternal life. It's not only we're storing up treasures in heaven, folks, it's that God's going to bless us within this current age, the life that we live now. I'm not saying you're going to be rich or drive a Porsche or a BMW. We're not preaching a prosper gospel, right? A prosperity gospel. What we're preaching is a gospel that I promise you that your life will be better following Jesus than it would be without him. I don't know if you're going to be poor, if you're going to be rich. Your life will be better following Jesus. What does blessings really look like in your life? If you were to close your eyes right now, let's do it. Let's just follow me. Close your eyes, all right? Let's all close our eyes. I'm not going to close my eyes because there's some steps up here, but close your eyes. Whenever you think of blessings, what's the first image that pops into your mind? When you think of blessings, don't give the answer away, Jenny. When you think of blessings, what's the first thing that pops into your mind? You can open your eyes. You see, in the past, whenever I thought of blessings, I thought of my house, thought of my cars, thought of my bank account, thought of all that stuff. We maintain that our blessing is in what we have instead of who we have. You know, I love my house. I do. We wouldn't have bought it if we didn't love it. We love our house. But I could care less about those four walls. What I care about, what makes it a house, is the people that I put in that house, right? That's my blessing. Shay and my two, I don't care. I know your kids are cute, but my kids are cuter. I'm just telling you. Those kids and my wife, that's what God's blessed me with. That's who God's entrusted me with. That's my blessing. Not the house that we live in. The people who live in the house are the blessing. That refuge, it is awesome. That's not the blessing. The kids that we put in there, that's the blessing. That's the reason why we do that. So the true cost to follow Jesus is to sell everything. Then those without anything are the ones who are truly blessed, in my opinion. Because all they have are each other. And they have Jesus. That's total dependency on him. Total dependency on him. This week I had a guy who's relatively new to the church. And I was like, so how have you enjoyed the weekend? I mean, what have you enjoyed the weekend? He's like, oh, I've loved it. I've loved every minute of it, except for one thing. I go, what, man? I go, is there any? He goes, I'm just uncomfortable with all the hugs. I go, yeah, we're a hugging place around here. But if that's the worst thing that happens, is a hug, we're doing pretty good. We can experience true blessing, when we don't think about it in terms of our stuff, but in terms of who gives us all of that stuff. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. If you have Jesus and you're serious about your relationship with him, you will be truly blessed, no doubt about it. So this week, throw that up there, Don, if you don't mind. We're going to do a hashtag, all right? I know that some of you are like, what's a hashtag? You know, oh, Don's not back there. We have a hashtag, true blessings, true blessings. What I want you to do is post on Twitter, social media, Periscope, whatever you have. I want you to post on all of that stuff with the hashtag, true blessings, of what you're truly blessed by. And listen, there's a lot of people in the world right now who are posting all over these social media things who think that they're blessed. We're blessed. Let the church of God rise up during this time and show our community and show the world what true blessings really look like. What are you truly blessed with? So today, right after church, I'm going to post on my Facebook page what I'm truly blessed by, and I hope that you do. You see a sunset when you're driving down I-70, pull over, stop your car, take a picture of the sunset, and post it as a true blessing. What is God blessing your life with? Think outside the box. Hashtag true blessings. It's all fine and good to talk about the true cost of following Jesus. But what's it going to take? What's it going to take? True cost of following Jesus is first to understand that you have to accept Jesus. Accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. That's what it's going to take. You cannot follow Jesus unless you accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. What does that look like? It looks like I believe in him with all my heart and all my mind. That's it. You accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Next, you commit to him. You commit everything that you have. You say, God, I don't care what it takes. Remember Job? Remember Job? Stripped of everything. Horrible situation. And he still praised God through it all. You commit to him. You commit everything that you have to him. Number three is that you trust him to transform your life. You trust him. That's the hardest one. Accepting Jesus is easy. Committing to him, okay, I'll commit to him, because we think commitment is a regular routine. Trusting him, that's the hard one. Trust him to change your condition. Trust him to change your sacrifice. Trust him to change your attitude. And then experience the true blessings that come along with it. When you trust God with all those things, he will bless you far greater than what anything that you can think in your mind of blessing really looks like. God has something for you. Admit, accept, commit, trust. Act. A-C-T. You have to act. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, the time is now to act and accept him. If you're here this morning and you need to commit to him through joining our church congregation, through being baptized and professing to other people that you accepted Jesus, now's the time to act. If you need to trust him in a deeper, intimate way to transform your life, now's the time to act.